So very first question for you is, I'd be really curious, as you think about yourself as a leader and running a company, what are one or two formative experiences that really sort of made you who you are as a leader?
Yeah, well, I could actually go back to when I was just a young boy and an experience with my father and Dr. Stephen R. Covey, who wrote The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And in that, he tells the story of trying to teach his son how to take care of the lawn, the yard. He called it green and clean. And really, it was a transformative experience for me at a very young age because of how it made me feel and the confidence it gave me. And long story made short is, you know, it was given out responsibilities to the kids and the family, and I volunteered to take care of the lawn, the yard. And this is in the days before automatic sprinklers. So you had to go out and manually turn them on. And we had this big lawn and all this grass. And he said, he trained me over a 2-week period. I was only 6 years old, by the way, on this, Whitney. So young. And he trained me and he said, we just have one clear goal in mind. We want the lawn to be green and clean. Green and clean, you know, and he trained me what green looked like. And he said, green is the color of our neighbor's yard, because ours was kind of yellow. And then here's what clean looks like. And over a 2-week period, he trained me. He told me how I achieved it was up to me, that if I wanted to, I could turn on the hose or I could use buckets or spit all day long or turn on the sprinklers, you know, but I was responsible for the result, green and clean. And then he said, once a week, we'll walk around the yard together and you'll tell me how we're doing. And I'm your helper if I have time. So it was a 2-week process. He trained me. Then he turned it over to me and I did nothing. And it was in the middle of the summer and the scorching, you know, heat, and the lawn was yellowing by the day. And it was Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, nothing, nothing, nothing. And the lawn literally was withering in front of his eyes. And he said that he just wanted to take the job right back from me, thinking, you know, he's just too young. But he kind of stayed with it and said, hey, son, why don't we walk around the yard like we agreed to we do once a week, and you can tell me how it's going, because that was our agreement. Mm-hmm. So we began to walk around and I looked around and the yard was anything but green. It was yellow and even browning and it was, you know, cluttered, anything but clean. We had a family barbecue over the weekend. There's garbage thrown everywhere. And I just knew I hadn't done the job. And I began to break down and cry. And I said, well, Dad, this is just so hard. You know, and he said, well, what's hard? You haven't done one thing. but what was hard was me as a young boy just kind of learning to take responsibility, to take ownership for this. And he said, would you like me to help you? And I said, would you? He said, I told you I would if I had time. And I said, do you have time? He said, I've got time. So I ran into the house and I got 2 garbage bags, 2 sacks, and I came out and I gave one to him. And I said, Dad, would you go over and pick up that garbage over there? Because it makes me want to vomit. So, you know, he followed my lead and he went over and did what I asked him to do. And it was at that moment that I began to realize and recognize that this was my job. Mm-hmm. I'm responsible. And my dad is responding to my direction. He's actually doing what I'm asking him to do. So from that moment, I began to take responsibility for that yard. And, you know, I only asked my dad for help a couple more times the rest of the summer. But from that day forward, the lawn was green and it was clean. It became my job, my stewardship, my responsibility. I kind of rose to the occasion. Now, my father will tell the story when he teaches 7 habits to talk about how this is a win-win performance agreement, or this was stewardship delegation. But I was a 6-year-old boy. I didn't know what those words meant, but what I knew and what I felt as a 6-year-old was simply this. I felt trusted. I felt my father trusted me and I didn't want to let him down. I was too young to be worried about allowance or status, but I didn't want to let my dad down. And I responded to the trust and I rose to the occasion and I took responsibility. And as I reflect back on that, I realized that kind of affirmation in me, of having someone believe in me, seeing my potential, and extending trust to me, helping me develop it and see it, and then not pulling back the trust when I didn't come through, but staying with it. And then me kind of learning and then responding and rising to the occasion and performing and then taking responsibility and being proud of the yard and making sure my brothers and sisters stayed off it to make sure they didn't mess it up. And, you know, just taking this responsibility, I kind of look back on that and say, while I was young, it kind of imprinted in my mind and in my heart, probably more than anything, that the power of being trusted, because what I remember is how I felt and how I felt trusted. And that inspired me and it brought out the best in me. And I rose to the occasion. And I thought about that countless times as I have then transitioned into other roles of leadership, of just that simple example of a father extending trust to a six-year-old. And if a six-year-old can be trusted, then maybe a 26 or a 36 or a 66-year-old can be trusted, you know? Mm-hmm. And so that idea, that simple little personal family experience had a profound impact on me. And I learned from my father the power of extending trust and of being trusted, of what it does to people, how it changes them, how it inspires them, how it brings out the very best in them.
So I have to ask this. Did you do something similar with your children when they were 6 years old?
I did. I waited until they were about eight.
Okay. They were eight. All right.
I waited a little longer thinking that maybe I'll give them a little bit of a runway. But yeah, I've passed that on to my kids, and they've all taken the responsibility at different times. It's easier today because we have automatic sprinklers, but still they take responsibility for mowing the lawn and keeping it, green and clean. It's kind of become, though, in the neighborhood, a little bit of an albatross around my neck, because if my yard ever gets out of line, then people know I'm not living the green and clean, green and clean principle. So I have a high standard to live up to in the neighborhood, but it has been a kind of a fun family tradition of teaching responsibility, of teaching stewardship delegation, of teaching trust and the power of trust and, being trusted.
You know, it's funny when I hear you tell that story and thinking of it as a parent, I reflect on how excruciating that must have been for your father with you to extend that trust.
Well, it was, especially when he was wondering, is he just too young? If I started too early, is he not ready for this? Am I setting him up to fail? Because he trained me for 2 weeks, we agreed to it. And then I just did nothing. And he told me that he wanted to just take the job back many times, especially when the lawn was dying in front of his eyes. And he was kind of embarrassed with the neighborhood and because it was all cluttered and messy. And he was kind of thinking, maybe it's just too young. Yeah. And he said that he was tempted to just go for efficiency and just say, I'll just do this. You're too young, but he stayed with it. But he does, when he tells the story, he has some fun with it. And I'll tell you a fun thing is before my father passed away, we had an opportunity to sometimes present together. And he talked about either the seven habits or the eighth habit in the morning. And then I talk about speed of trust in the afternoon. And when he would introduce me, he'd tell the green and clean story without giving all elements of it. And I'd get up and I'd say, then let me tell you my side of the story. And I'd point out that I was only 6 years old. Come on, what do you expect of a 6 year old? Kind of like I was framed type of thing. We had a lot of fun. It was a little bit of a fun dialogue back and forth with us. And then I tell a funny story about my dad accidentally leaving my mom on the side of the road on a freeway one time. And it was just this fun, playful banter. Yeah. And I just look back on that with fond memories of these experiences.
Yes. I was going to ask you, is this a crucible type experience that led you? I need to show everybody. Here is his book, The Speed of Trust. It's kind of backwards, but that's okay. So yeah, what's a formative, possibly crucible experience that led you to think even more about the idea of trust and the importance of it?
Yeah. So while it was imprinted in my mind and implanted in my heart from a young age, it wasn't really until I had a crucible type experience when I you know, I'd been the CEO of Covey Leadership Center, my father's company that he established, and helped try to build that to operate all around the world and take seven habits and principle-centered leadership, the things we were doing. And we were having some great success, and we started operating in about 40 countries and, you know, really build a brand and a reputation, and we're growing the business, became very profitable, these types of things, all good measures. Mm-hmm. And then we made the decision that we would merge with our arch competitor, you know, our nemesis, the Franklin Quest organization. We'd both gone heavy into time management. You know, my father wrote the book, First Things First. And so we'd gone into time management. They were into time management. They were the bigger player, more established, and they were a publicly traded company. You know, so we merged companies with these two arch competitors coming together. And I'll tell you what, it was quite a bit messy at first because merging companies, you know, content companies that have, you know, a methodology, a dogma, if you will, is kind of like merging religions. I mean, people are just, you know, very clear about their approach and their format, their methodology. And it was very challenging. And, you know, we kind of knew it would be, but it was probably 10x what we thought. Oh. And so suddenly we were really kind of slowed down by the distrust that entered everywhere, where every decision was seemingly politicized. Every action was seen through the lens of, is this a Covey person? Is this a Franklin person? Who's making this decision? What's their criteria? And we all got tarnished by it. And I got tarnished by it too. I'd been the CEO of Covey Leadership Center. Now we're merging, and I'm taking responsibility for the education and training business. And half the people didn't trust me. And it wasn't that I'd done bad things to lose the trust. It just kind of was a natural outcome of merging companies that had been arch competitors and saw the world through a completely different lens. But I'd certainly done nothing to earn and build and gain their trust. Mm. And we realized that there was a high cost to low trust because we were so internally focused as opposed to focusing on the customer. We were slow in responding. We were all into our own heads about what we're trying to do and who was right and who had what ideas, but we were not customer centric or responsive. We were slow. We became really cumbersome and our revenue started to go down and our profit started to go down and we started to become less innovative. And it was, you know, not achieving the synergies of what the merger was supposed to do. We finally realized our problem here is not the capabilities and the assets we have collectively. It was that we didn't trust each other, and we couldn't collaborate and innovate, and we couldn't celebrate our differences without this trust and create something better. So we became very deliberate and intentional. And for me, you know, I was the leader of this group here. I had to recognize that half the group doesn't trust me, and I've got to earn that trust. And I tried to, when it became clear about it, you know, at first I was defensive, thinking,
I've done nothing. I was going to ask you, how did that feel when you realized people didn't trust you?
It felt awful. And I was very defensive at first, very defensive with what, you know, I've done nothing to lose the trust. You know, I always do what I say I'm going to do and these types of things. But then I finally had to just kind of step back and say, Stephen, don't be defensive. Don't argue for your weakness here. You know, this is the reality. Got to confront reality here that half the group doesn't trust me. Half did, half didn't. And it'd be very easy to just kind of point the finger and say, well, it's their fault, you know. But no, I had to realize I'd done nothing to earn it. Well, I'd maybe done nothing in my mind to lose it. I'd certainly really done nothing yet to earn it. So I really, you know, kind of once I overcame the kind of the shock of this, and the vulnerability of gosh, I always pride myself on being a high trust leader. Now half the group doesn't trust me. Then I took responsibility to say, okay, I've got to behave my way into greater trust. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, words alone won't do it. It's got to be actions, got to be behavior.